Hi, good evening. Good to see all of you tonight, and good to see a few of you online. And I know more of you will be coming on in just a bit here. We got a few more people coming in. Come on in. Come on in. We're open. So good to see so many faces tonight. Just want to welcome you to our Wednesday evening service. We're in for a treat tonight. We're in lesson number two. Richard's been doing a prayer series, and it's going through some different prayers in the Bible. And so I look forward to this next one here, and I know you do as well. So as we begin our worship, let's open up with a word of prayer. Father, we bow down before you tonight, God. We continue to pray for our sister Karen as she has gone through hip replacement surgery today. We thank you for that positive report. We pray for continued healing over her body. And we continue to pray for Phil Hunt, God, that you'd heal him. And continue to pray for the McGinnis family and all family members related to Susie's passing. We pray that you'd be with them, that you'd continue to give them strength and fill them with your peace and presence during this time of loss. Father, we pray that you'd give us a heart of worship tonight. We pray for all of the many requests within our congregation, God, all of those spoken and unspoken requests. We pray for those tonight, and we just pray in faith, God, that you will answer those and how you see fit. We trust you, Father. Give us a heart of worship tonight. Teach us how to pray, Lord. I'm excited about this lesson tonight. Teach us how to pray. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship. Thank you.
Jesus, here's my heart and my life, God. What do you want to do with it? Dear Jesus, I pray that that's our prayer. That's my prayer. And you see my heart, Father, and you see everybody's heart here, God. God, help us to express what you know is in our hearts. Change what is in our hearts to reflect you, Father. God, we love you. Help us to learn about some wonderful things about prayer tonight and how to communicate with you better, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Going to be the TV evangelist tonight and hold on to this thing. Well, praise the Lord. Everybody enjoying this nice, comfortable summer Arizona weather? No, okay. An honest answer there. It's also the time of the year when, one of the things that at least has been thought about, I don't know whether it's actually happened yet, but this is the time of the year when school usually starts. And I'm not sure exactly where Florence is at and all of that, but it's that time of the year when, in the normal routine, which we're not in anymore, but in the normal routine, kids would be preparing to go back to school and meet their teachers. And I just wanted to start out tonight thinking about teachers. And I need to elicit some feedback from you. I want you to think about who was your most interesting or influential teacher, the one that you remember the most, or the one that you remember learning something from the most. Does anybody have someone that just kind of pops into their mind? Nobody, huh? Okay. So what was it about, obviously your mom, it's pretty hard to be too negative there, but what was it about the way she taught that, you know, inspired you or, you know, provided you with an experience, enabled you to grab a hold of a subject or a skill that just has stayed with you?
Well, her funeral was packed with former students, and they all said that she just went above and beyond. Like, they knew she loved them unconditionally. She would pray for them. She would give them, you know, buy things with their own money if they needed, you know, soap or different things. Like, just tried to meet their tangible needs and love on them. And yeah.
Okay. Okay, good. Anybody else? This highly educated group, surely there's a teacher that stood out in your mind.
Because he was gave me so much feedback in regards to how I was doing.
Okay.
And he made me feel good about what I was doing. Therefore, he was one of my favorite teachers.
Good, good. Anyone else?
So I had an instructor in college, and he was a judge here in Pinal County. Help me out with his name, Hank Gooday. I don't know. And he was just very encouraging and very, you know, the subject matter could be, you know, maybe not always that interesting, but he always made it interesting and relevant and just very encouraging. And I've seen him around town, and he's still that encourager and that just stuck with me as a student that you know, this person really seemed to care about my education and my future.
Okay, good. Well, I bring this up because Jesus is probably the el primo teacher. And we're going to look at a couple of things tonight. I had to be selective in the material because there was so much of it. But the interesting thing about Jesus is he didn't teach the way most of us experience teaching. He never told his disciples to go sit in a classroom for so many hours. He didn't give them books to read and write research papers on. He didn't do any educational stuff the way you and I have been given our education. He used something completely different. And his goal was always, then and still is, life transformation. Life transformation. And this is something that's been kind of pounded into my head for a long period of time. But if my life isn't being transformed as I read the scriptures, as I encounter God in prayer, if my life isn't changing, then there's something wrong. Okay? I'm just kind of going through motions. I can stuff my head with a lot of facts about the Bible. I might even be good at being able to engage in arguments with people about the Bible. But if my life isn't changing, then I'm not moving in the direction that Jesus wants me to move in. So, last week I gave you a little bit of I decided the picture is worth a thousand words, and if you didn't remember it, this is what I had in mind, okay? A little scale here, 0 to 10, how is your prayer life, was the question. So you can scribble on the back of a piece of paper or something, or, you know, and then where would you like it to be? Simple diagram, simple questions. That's what I think Jesus wants to get across to us here. He wants our prayer life to go someplace. He doesn't want it to stall. Well, tonight, I'm going to focus in on some life-changing teachings on prayer. And as we touch on them, you're probably not going to think at the get-go that this is really anything at all about prayer. But there is a key point in each one of these episodes, I'll call them, in Jesus's ministry here, that is very, very important when it comes to prayer. Now, we kind of left last week. We were in the Gospel of Matthew, and we're in there tonight. And we were in the fifth chapter, sixth chapter, seventh chapter, Matthew's Gospel, generally known as the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said a lot of things in that sermon that shook people up. He said a lot of things that just totally went against the grain of what the people were used to hearing. And I think he did that probably for a number of reasons, but it got their attention. At the end of the sermon, their comments were that he taught and spoke with authority. They recognized something, even though I'm sure it made many of them uncomfortable. But I want to start tonight in Matthew's Gospel. Let's see if I can get us there. And Jesus, his teaching method, last week I told you he used he used contrast, comparison. And this week we're going to look at a couple of episodes. And this, I believe, still today is what Jesus does the most in every one of our lives. In every one of our lives. But we miss this so often. And it's the teaching method called the teachable moment. You know what I'm talking about. The teachable moment. Best illustrated, for instance, when people say they're going to pray and ask God for more patience because they're an impatient person. Anybody ever prayed that? Ask God that? I don't know how long ago it was that I realized this, but, you know, that's a good prayer, except the only way it's going to be answered is to find yourself in situations that demand patience. That's the only way that prayer is going to be answered. But most of the time we pray that prayer and prayers like that, really hoping that all that Jesus would have to do is just kind of open our head and pour a little patience in there and we're good to go. Kind of like filling up your car with gas. But it doesn't work that way. And when we look at how Jesus worked with his disciples, we see that Jesus uses teachable moments. And of course, in our day and age, since we're not walking right with Jesus the way that the disciples did, sometimes it takes us a little longer to go, aha, that was a teachable moment. Did I learn what God wanted me to learn from it? And if you're anything like me, I've missed a bunch of teachable moments in my life, and sometimes he has to send us back around the block and get us back to that teachable moment again. Sometimes again and again and again. We're going to pick up the story here in Matthew's Gospel. I guess I told Tom I was going to do the reading here. Let me get in the right chapter. And where am I at? All right, Matthew chapter 9, and I'm going to start with, let's see here. There it is. Okay. All right, so Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. So after he's done with the Sermon on the Mount, he begins his itinerant ministry, and he's touching the lives of people through his preaching and his healing ministry. People are hearing the good news. People are being healed. It's an amazing time. So Jesus sees these crowds of people that are beginning to come to him. And he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So this is the situation, or I guess I would say the teachable moment. Right now, Jesus has got he's got lots of crowds that are following him, but he's got these guys that you and I know as his disciples, people who want to learn. That's what the word means, learner. And he's establishing his ministry. It was common for the rabbis in Jesus' day to have a group of individuals around them that were their disciples, that they poured their life into and that they were teaching. So Jesus was beginning to establish these guys as his disciples. They're a little bit beyond followers at this point. They're with him in a little bit of a closer way, and he's spending a little bit more time focused on them as well as on the crowds. But the word you need to focus on in this passage that relates to our topic of prayer is that when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. That word compassion, I believe, is an underlying word when it comes to prayer. Now this whole passage here is one that maybe we would be tempted to link it if we were doing good Christianese speaking and church language stuff, we'd link it to evangelism. We'd probably read this story here, this episode, and we'd probably come away with it thinking maybe a little bit about evangelism. But I want to tell you, it isn't just about evangelism, it's about prayer. And the only way evangelism is going to be successful is through prayer. And Jesus looked upon the crowds that he saw, the situation, he describes them as harassed and helpless, and he sees them like sheep scattered without a shepherd to defend them, to feed them, to take care of them. He had compassion. And so in this teaching, I believe Jesus is telling us when it comes to prayer, we have to have compassion. We have to have compassion. The goal of our prayers, if we don't see through the lens of compassion the way Jesus did, I don't think we'll do much praying. And it's probably true that the prayers that we do pray may not go very far. They may be like an arrow that's shot from a bow that's got a weak string to it and just kind of goes and drops. It doesn't really make it to its target. And we probably won't maintain much of a prayer life if we don't have compassion. Let's see, did I have some more scriptures? So he says to his disciples, as he's looking out here, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. He's creating a picture to them as he's looking out and he's seeing this broken mass of humanity. And he's been engaged in ministry. And he himself is realizing what a huge task this is and how important it's going to be for these guys that are with him to be equipped for the ministry, and they need to see through this lens of compassion. But it isn't going to be enough. They're going to need more. There's not enough of him to go around. And so he says, the harvest is plentiful, the workers are few, but ask the Lord of the harvest, or pray to the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. When we begin to look through the lens of compassion in our prayers, we begin to see the harvest fields that God sees. Now, sometimes we come up short and maybe we don't pray as often as we should because there's too many harvest fields out there and we get overwhelmed. But I believe that for each one of us, there's at least one harvest field, at least one harvest field, that God's going to pour some compassion into your heart on. He's going to fill your heart with compassion for at least one of those harvest fields. And the other thing about praying for the Lord to send out workers into his harvest field, you really can't pray for God to do that unless what? Unless you're willing to be one of the harvesters. And I think that's the prayer principle that Jesus is giving to these guys here. He sees this mass of humanity, this broken, needy, and he's been doing some things. They've been watching him. They've been listening to him. And I wondered sometimes if they're not getting a little nervous, wondering what's going to happen next. And so they're with Jesus. They're with Jesus. And got a different Bible here, so I can't find exactly where I wanted to be here. But one of the things Jesus does in this chapter, after all is said and done, in chapter 10, I don't have it up there, in chapter 10, in the very first verses, Jesus calls these guys together. And it says he endowed them with the authority to heal sickness and disease and drive out those who were possessed of demons. He gave them authority. Now, that's very interesting. The Base Camp Men's Group has been engaged in a study about the church, and the question of authority has come up as we've talked about the church and God's purpose for the church and his vision and his destiny for the church. And one of the things that is there consistently in the scripture is that God has given his church authority. Now, what does that mean? That'd be a whole teaching on itself, just talking about the authority that God has given to us. But, you know, when you're going down the road and you're going too fast and the little light goes on and you see it in the rearview mirror, you get the impression that you need to pull off to the side of the road because the person in that car wants to have a word with you. And they get out and, you know, they give you some instructions. And why can they do that? They have the authority. Exactly. They have the authority to do that. And you stop and think about that simple illustration, which all of us have probably found ourselves in at least once in our lifetime. And you ask yourself, well, why do I pull over like that? Why do I do that? Because that person has the authority. Now, I want to just throw this out there to you and say that the church has authority because Jesus gave it authority. The question is, how are we handling that authority? Do we believe we have it? Do we have the courage to use it the way Jesus intended it to be used? He obviously intended it to be used. He wouldn't have given it to us otherwise. And so this whole question of authority comes up here. Jesus equips his disciples right here at the beginning to do what he's been doing, because the harvest is so great. You can't send these guys into the harvest unless they're equipped with what they need to reap the harvest. So he does that. So the first principle that he gives them is the need for compassion, the call to pray for harvesters. That's one of the goals. And then we have quite a few chapters here where they're with Jesus, and Jesus continues to touch the lives of people. And then we get over into chapter 17. Chapter 17 in Matthew's Gospel is an interesting one. It's been about 2 years, 2.5 years since that initial being equipped with the authority, and a lot has transpired, and Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem for the last time. And Matthew 17 is that incredible experience that Peter and John have with Jesus. They go up on this mountaintop, and they have the mountaintop experience of all mountaintop experiences. And in the midst of all of that mountaintop experience, they want to do what most people want to do. They want to build something for God that God never asked them to build, but they really do want to do it. But that's not part of the plan. So there they are. They're on top of the mountain. The other nine guys are down in the valley down there someplace. So we tend to focus our attention on what's happening on the mountain. But down in the valley where the rest of the disciples are, something interesting is happening. Some of those needy people who need the compassion that Jesus was talking about. Well, I'll pick it up in verse 14. They had come down from the mountain, and as they headed toward town, came to a crowd. As they approached the crowd, a man rushed up to Jesus and kneels down in front of him and begs him to have mercy on him and his son. His son has seizures, Scripture says. When he has those seizures, he falls into the fire sometimes, or maybe into the water, into deep water. And so his father is very, very, very concerned about him. And they bring him to those disciples that were down in the valley. The man brings them. Now, maybe he knows that the disciples of Jesus have been doing the same things that Jesus, healing and delivering people. And so they didn't necessarily want to wait until Jesus was present. He believed that Jesus' followers could solve the issue that he was bringing to them. Problem is, they couldn't. Couldn't do it. So that raises the question, here is a group of guys whom we've just read Jesus poured his authority into, the authority to cast out demons, to heal, to do exactly what Jesus was doing. He gave that to these individuals at the beginning of his ministry. They had probably had been engaged in doing that through their time with Jesus, but now they reach a place where they couldn't. They couldn't do it. I've always been somewhat taken aback, and it depends on which translation you read, as to how severe the next few verses come across. But if you ever pictured Jesus getting upset with his disciples, this is one of those verses. Okay? Now, in verse 12 in this translation, it said, "This generation is no better than the generation who wandered in the desert, who lost faith, and bowed down to golden idols as soon as Moses disappeared up Mount Sinai. How long will I have to shepherd these unbelieving sheep? Yeah. How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Makes you wonder the tone of voice Jesus was using here. You know, we don't often picture, you know, the nice, mild, soft-spoken Jesus. He was upset. He was upset. And bring the boy here. Bring him over here. It's almost like, I was also thinking about the scenario here too, you know, because Peter was on the mountain with Jesus, and you know Peter, you know his actions, and I can kind of picture the scenario where, you know, he's standing there with John, and it's becoming evident that the other brothers weren't doing what they should have done. And I can kind of picture Peter say, step aside, guys. You know, I just kind of picture Peter doing that. But we don't have anything recorded about what Peter said or didn't say here, but I just kind of pictured him doing that. So Jesus rebuked the demon. It came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. And then the disciples came to Jesus in private. No way were they going to be public about this whole thing. They were probably a little bit embarrassed. And they asked Jesus why they couldn't cast this demon out. And Jesus says, because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. That's okay. That's okay. I'm going to get some feedback on this anyway, because this was a verse that came up in our base camp men's meeting last week. The guys were really... really good. I asked for it, and they delivered. Okay. And I expect I'll get the same off of this one. But this was one of the verses that one of the brothers brought up about prayer and why we haven't seen too many mountains moved. So I'm looking at this, and I'm doing some study on this, and I see the problem that we have with this verse is that we get caught up thinking that it's a quantity of faith that Jesus is talking about here. But as I forget what the word is, and I'm not going to be able to say it anyway, there is a... the Greek word that is better translated, instead of little faith, flawed faith. Flawed faith is a better picture of what Jesus is saying here. You have a flawed faith. And I read that, and I thought about that, and I thought, that answers a lot. That answers a lot. Here were these guys who had physically been in the presence of Jesus. Jesus poured in the authority that they needed to do all this kind of ministry. And yet, over the course of the 2.5 years or so of ministry that they were doing together, they got to a point where Jesus' comment to them was they had a flawed faith at that point. And so I stopped to think about the lack of authority that we have in the church today, our lack of authority, our lack of presence in the society that we live in, and I came up short and I thought, is it because the church has a flawed faith? Possibly. possibly. You did, huh? He says this kind of demon, going back to the problem at hand, he says, won't leave unless you've prayed and fasted, gone without food. So they couldn't do what they had been doing because they had a flawed faith. And Jesus was pointing out that this was a situation that demanded prayer and fasting. Those two things go together quite frequently in Scripture, and if we had more time, we'd move into that part of prayer as well. But just, you know, I toss it out there for you and for your own personal study and reading to think about. But those two key points tonight then leave you with is the fact that Jesus calls us to bring compassion to our prayers. And to realize that when we pray with compassion, he may very well call us to be a part of the answer to that prayer, to the focus of that compassionate prayer. And then the second thing is to realize that many of the obstacles that we confront, either individually or corporately as a church, we don't see results that we want to see. We don't see the results that we think should be there. We don't see the mountains moved that we feel should be moved. And the Scripture seems to tell us can be moved. Is there a flaw in my faith? Is there a flaw in my faith? Now, I know you're probably all just waiting there telling me what to do about the flaw. I don't know what to do about the flaw. Okay? We can have a flaw in a lot of different things in our lives that we encounter. Sometimes they can be fixed and sometimes they can't. Sometimes they have to be broken down and taken apart and started all over and rebuilt. Jesus obviously didn't do that with the disciples. So maybe we need to just press on and read a little bit more about them. They were still struggling with his whole message about what was going to happen. As they were on their way to Jerusalem, they missed the point continuously. And it wasn't really till after the Holy Spirit came that they finally got it. So I guess if I was to say and conclude with anything, it's that we desperately need the presence and fullness of the Holy Spirit to fix the flaws in our faith. Amen. Don't forget your score here. You got to do this before we're done. Oh, before Carla starts singing, I just wanted to put in a plug for Men's Group Base Camp that meets Thursday night and Saturday morning via Zoom Thursday and Saturday morning by both Zoom, and some make their way to Tom Burke's house, which is at 3347 North Spyglass here in Florence. And I invite any of the men that are here, any of them that are listening, to come and be a part of that. We have some good times, and we kid one another. We get a lot out of it, though. And
along those lines, Coolidge is having a Promise Keepers event Friday and Saturday morning. Well, Friday evening and Saturday morning.
This
if
week.
You go to, yeah, Promise Keepers or the Coolidge's website. I have actually advertised it for our men, so that might be something you might want to tell your guys.
We can talk about that Thursday night.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was also going to, when I talked with John about doing this series, I mentioned to him that the Alpha Ministry twice a year has what they call a Kingdom Come prayer. And August 18th through the 20th is their second one for the year. And that obviously will be pretty much done by local churches in the situations that we're in. But we can go online if the church here is interested in engaging in that to get ideas. They have a whole host of things that churches can do to engage in this. But the idea is that Christians are praying 24, I won't say 24/7, but the 3 days that they're covering this, that there'll be intense prayer saturation going up. So I think the church sees the need for effective, fervent prayer. So, bless us. I'll close in prayer when you're done singing, because
okay,
I have a prayer. Okay.
Perfect. This next song is Glorious Ruins, and you know, sometimes we feel like maybe we don't have that compassion, or we're not ready to pray and bring ourselves before God, but you know what? It's God that renews our spirit, right? We bring our ruins to him, and he brings us to life through him, right? We have life in Christ. And so we can come before him, the great and almighty God, which is amazing. And he will actually give us that compassion and everything. So it's a cycle, you know? Anyway, God is good.
When the mountains fall and the tempest roars, you are with me. When creation folds, still my soul will soar on your mercy. And I'll walk with my head lifted high and my spirit revived in your story. And I'll look to the cross as my failure is lost in the light of your glorious grace. Let the ruins come to life in the beauty of your name. Rising up from the ashes, God forever reigns, and my soul will find refuge in the shadow of your wings. I will love you forever, and forever I'll sing. When the world caves in, still my hope will cling to your heart finds strength in your presence. And I'll walk through the fire with my head lifted high and my spirit revived in your story. And I'll look to the cross as my failure is lost in the light of your glorious grace. Let the ruins come to life in the beauty of your name. Rising up from the ashes, God forever you reign. And my soul will find refuge in the shadow of your wings. I will love you forever. Forever, I'll sing. soul will find refuge in the shadow of your wings. I will love you forever, God, forever.
Let's bow our heads. Oh, Father in heaven, you have designed our bodies to serve you and our souls to follow closely after you. It is with sorrow and repentance of heart that we acknowledge before you the faults and failures and flaws of today. For too long, we've tried your patience and too often betrayed your trust. And yet, you still want us to come with humble heart, as we do now. Lord, forgive us for our failures to walk truthfully. Excuse us for the temptations, Forgive us for choosing the worst when we know the better. And forgive us for our failures to apply to ourselves the standards we often demand of others. Forgive us for the blindness and lack of compassion to the suffering of others around us. Forgive us for apathy toward wrongs that may not directly impact me, and forgive us for being oversensitive to those that do. Forgive us for our slowness to see the good in others and see the flaws, failure to see the flaws in ourselves. And so we pray with David, the words of his psalm, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within us. Do not cast us away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore to us the joy of our salvation, and sustain in us a willing spirit." Amen. God bless.